Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Doesn't matter what time of day. I'm still happy you stopped by my channel. If we're meeting for the first time, my name is Reverend Paul J. Bern, and I'm the online pastor of the online church and faith-based community known as the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center. We're based in Atlanta, Georgia, sending blog posts and videos around the world. This is a church that's not a traditional church at all. We are online only. We have a mailing address, but there's no church to be found there. We don't teach traditional religion. We don't teach different denominational teachings of any kind. You will find no political ideology being blended in with your faith at this church, on this website. What you will find in very large doses is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, crucified, died, and resurrected on the morning of that third day, or that beautiful morning. Yes, indeed it was. And even now he sits at his Father's right hand, waiting for the queue to come and take the rest of us home, so that we may spend eternity with him together. That's what this blog and this channel are about. For today, this is going to be the Sunday message that was posted this morning at 6:30. This is obviously the video version of that, so let me go ahead and shoot this thing and get this rolling here. I have decided to title this week's message, Sunday message, Why Most of the American People Need to Take Anger Management Classes. There's going to be nothing sugar-coated about this message, so brace yourselves. Some of what I say here may be hard for some of you to hear, but hear it you must if you want to continue your walk and your growth in Christ Jesus, your Lord and Savior. And so, America has a problem. Gun violence. Rampant gun violence. It's gotten me to thinking about what are the root causes of all this? Where is this even coming from to begin with? And where the heck did all these guns come from? Well, I think the least common denominator of why all this violence is going on, that we're currently plagued with, and we certainly got a problem with it here in Atlanta lately, is people being either unable to, or worse yet, refusing to, control their tempers. More on that in a couple of minutes. So I'm writing about the recent flood of shootings here in Atlanta, where I live and work, and elsewhere. But I'm particularly this week writing about my hometown of Atlanta, Georgia, or adopted hometown. I've lived here since 1983. I guess that's long enough to call it a hometown. If you check my bio on LinkedIn, I'm originally from the Cincinnati, Ohio area. but that's been a lifetime ago. Now, there have been a flurry of shootings here in Atlanta, here in the ATL, that have left me troubled. Let me cite the following news headlines for examples. You will see these news headlines in the description on the video itself for those links. I've got two of them coming from the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, which is the newspaper here in town, and a third one about mass shootings all across America from Fox 5 Atlanta. Mass shootings, the headline says. 6 dead, dozens injured. And I think this is going on just about far enough. Somebody's got to take a leadership role in this and try to solve this problem. I don't see anybody else around me doing anything, so I guess I'll undertake this myself. So I'm going to start off my management of that by asking you all a question. Has anyone ever heard of a concept known as anger management? Actually, it's more than just a concept. It's one of the precepts of psychology, human psychology. And to a similar extent, sociology. I can see two main reasons for all the gun violence, at least here in Atlanta. The first I can sum up in two words. As I said, anger management, or more accurately, the lack thereof on the part of all too many Americans of all races, ethnicities, and complexions. Too many people are using their emotions instead of their minds for processing thoughts and feelings. This will require some people to adopt new ways of thinking. Hello? More on this at the end, or more about that at the end of the message. The second main reason I can sum up for all the gun violence is I can sum it up in one word this time: greed. Greed. For all you people out there who thought Gordon Gekko had the right idea when he said in that movie Wall Street that greed is good, if anybody out there really believes that, you're lost. But before you get mad and turn off your channel here, hear me out. I'm trying to do some good here. There are too many people out here in the streets trying to shake down too many other people for a quick, easy profit. The fact that much of this stems from the lack of economic opportunity, combined with, at least here in Georgia, starvation wages that are on a par with the 1960s, the fact that all those things are coming into play changes nothing. Allow me to share a few examples of what the Bible says about this. Hey, I'm a minister, right? This is what I do. This is part of who I am. Let's find out, examine what the Bible has to say about anger management. The first thing that has to do with the source of a lot of the violence out there right now, gangs. Atlanta has a gang problem. Just about every major city in the country has a gang problem. And it's now spreading to the small towns too. Well, this little subtitle here, there's in the middle of this subheading on the blog, is the gang problem in the Bible. Now, let me give you a Bible verse about gangs and being in gangs, the thug life, as they call it. I'm going to quote to you from the book of Proverbs in the Bible, back in the Old Testament. And I quote, "My son," says the word, "if sinners entice you, do not give in to them. If they say, come along with us, let's lie in wait for someone's blood, let's waylay some harmless soul, let's swallow them alive like the grave, and whole like those who go down to the pits. We will get all sorts of valuable things and fill our houses with plunder. Throw in your lot with us and we will share a common purse. My son," when you hear that or anything like that, "do not go along with them. Do not set foot on their paths, for their feet rush into sin, and they are swift to shed innocent blood." That's Proverbs chapter 1, verses 8 through 16, from the Amplified Bible. Now, these verses that I have just read describe the gang problem here in the U.S., which is quite substantial, very well. As you all know, youth plus a sense of belonging minus any positive role models at home and minus any real chance at economic or educational opportunities equals future gang members. If our youth can't find the love and the acceptance and the guidance they need from home and from church, they will go and get it somewhere else. Invariably, when that occurs, they wind up hanging around with the wrong crowd. That's pretty much the way it goes darn near every time. Well, it is time, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it is time for some tough love from Pastor Paul. There is more to America's anger management issues than what I have described at this point. People react emotionally instead of thoughtfully because they allow evil things like greed, pride, and a bad temper to rule over them. As it is written, and I quote, "A fool finds pleasure in evil conduct, but a man of understanding delights in wisdom," or a woman of understanding. That's Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 23 is where that one came from. But isn't there more to it than just that, you ask? Well, you're right, it's more than just a lack of understanding. Some people need to grow up and learn to control their tempers and to cease provoking other people. And here's the scripture for that. And I quote, "A gentle answer turns away wrath,
but a harsh word stirs up anger. Closed quote. That's from Proverbs. Here we are back in the book of Proverbs again. This time, chapter 15 and verse 1. That's where that came from. And again it is written in that same book of Proverbs. And I quote, a hot-tempered man stirs up dissension, or a hot-tempered woman. But a patient man or woman calms a quarrel. Close quote. This last time around, it's Proverbs chapter 15, and that's verse 18, is where that one came from. So, the question becomes, where did love go? First, we were talking a minute ago about evil conduct, and now we're talking about where did this opposite go? Where does love go? But at the end of the day, those who commit gun violence have one common denominator, a lack of love in their lives. Hatred has replaced love in a world that can't stop hating because it doesn't know how. The reason some people don't know how to stop hating, nor how to start loving, is because they refuse to take the Bible and its teachings seriously. Moreover, there is no love because there is no trust due to fear. People are afraid to trust one another because they're afraid if they do, they might miss out on something more beneficial. Having forgotten that mutual trust itself is beneficial, as is mutual love. Right, they go hand in hand. The Apostle John put it to the best when he wrote, or put it best, I should say, when he wrote, excuse me. And here comes a nice Bible quote from the Apostle John. This is the message you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brother's were righteous. Do not be surprised, my brothers, my sisters, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love our brothers and sisters. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Anyone who hates his brother is a murderer, and you know that no murderer has eternal life in Christ. No unrepentant murderer, to clarify. You can't commit murder and still ultimately be forgiven. That's what happened with Moses. Moses was a wanted man. He was wanted for murder in Egypt. He fled to what is now Iraq, modern Iraq today. So you can be forgiven, but you got to come to the Lord, confess your sins, take your punishment. You'll be forgiven. Enough said about that, I guess. Let's see here. This is how we know. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our own brothers and sisters. And that comes from 1 John in chapter 3, verses 11 through 16, is where that those verses came from. But Jesus said it best of all, and I quote, "Teacher," he was asked, "what is the greatest commandment of the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord with all your heart and with all your soul and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second one is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." Closed quote. That came from Matthew chapter 22, verses 36 through 40. Now, this brings us back full circle to our original question. And this, as well as this business about a course in anger management that was in the title of this piece. Where does anger come from? You can get all the details from the link that's located in here. It's it's living with fitness. .com. Bear with me. livingwithfitness.com/anger-management. So there you go. Or it'll be there in the blog. You can just click on the link there in the text. But to sum it up, anger can come from hate or rage, but it could also be a result of being offended or from being assaulted or insulted. Sometimes anger comes when we see someone being taken advantage of, or of someone being ripped off somehow. But other times, anger comes from being too impatient. It's as if to say to another, "Who do you think you are by slowing down my progress or by being in my way?" Now, this very thing, right here, this is how a lot of these road rage incidents getting started. Drivers deliberately provoking other drivers. Here in Atlanta, it's not unheard of for a driver to shoot another in traffic for being too impatient when in rush hour traffic, and Atlanta has a whole lot of heavy traffic. Trust me. The solution then is for more disciplined behavior on the part of everybody, everywhere. This part right here is it's time for me to put on my leadership hat. So, on it goes. The solution is for more disciplined behavior. Period. End of story. Driving faster than anyone else will only make a difference of 2 to 3 minutes relative to the driver's arrival, the driver's usual arrival time at their destination. Driving fast and hard will also wear out your car or your truck sooner rather than later. At the end of the day, it's time for some people out there to grow up. You know who you are. Under no circumstances is shooting another driver who got in your way worth all the time that you would spend in prison. Yes, for all you traffic bullies who are out there, the ones who flash your lights and honk your horns at people. Get out of my way, get out of my way. I have a bit of news for you. Bullies are takers. And takers are losers. Why be a loser? Come on, make some effort. Be a winner. Transform yourself into a winner. Oh, yes, you can do it. Yes, you can do it. Yes, you are strong enough. Don't let anybody tell you anything to the contrary. If they do, they don't know what they're talking about, or they're trying to slow down your progress, possibly out of jealousy. It happens all the time. So, it's time for some people to reiterate, some people out there to grow up. You know who you are. And bullies are takers. Traffic bullies. Office bullies. Bullies in relationships. All of them, they're takers. And takers are losers. It's time for everybody to grow up and get a real life. Cancel your subscriptions to the blog here if you must. Really, please don't. But the truth is still the truth. And I stand on the side of truth every day of the year. Here at the end of the message, if you're in a traditional brick-and-mortar church, they pass around the collection basket. Well, I am online only. I do not have a collection basket. One thing you'll never hear me say or ask for is for people to give me 10% of their incomes each week. I don't do that. First of all, we're online. We don't have a church building, so what would I need all that money for? No. The purpose for this blog, of this channel, is what I said it was at the top. To teach and preach Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and all the aspects thereof in a modern 21st century format that people can relate to and they can easily understand. That's what I'm here to do. So, one thing for sure, if you don't have any money to send anyway, don't worry about it. You'll never ever be judged for that here. But if you're able, a donation would be appreciated. You can donate either on PayPal, and the email address for PayPal, for this, for the church account, is greatestservant62@gmail.com. That's all one word, all lowercase. greatestservant62@gmail.com. You can also donate on Stripe. Just go to Stripe's homepage at stripe.com. Search Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center. Pops right up. Send off any amount you like. All your gifts are very much appreciated. All the money goes to the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center. None of it goes to me. I do not get a salary for doing this. I do this for free. But keeping this up on the website, I'm about to put up a new website too, plus all the other things I'm doing. It costs money. So, if you can help, it would be greatly appreciated. But, having said all that, before you go, please give me a thumbs up, a share, and most of all, a subscribe. The subscription on YouTube is free, and you'll have access to the blog too, and to my archives, both on the blog and on YouTube. I got two sets of archives, so you can watch them in the video format if you prefer to. And I guess that's all for this go around. I want to stop before I go just to say that I appreciate each and every one of you, and to thank you. I thank you for the privilege of your time. And so, having nothing further to say, everybody be blessed. Yes, I said be blessed. In Jesus' mighty name.